Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Fat of the Land, Adventures of a 21st Century Forager, by Langdon Cook, narrated by Patrick Lawlor. Author's Note. The Oxford Dictionary of English, one of the more modern volumes in Oxford's vast reference library, defines the verb forage, F-O-R-A-G-E, as to search widely for food or provisions. This is in contrast to earlier definitions that centered largely on the word's militaristic underpinnings, dating from at least the early 15th century, when foraging, F-O-R-R-A-G-E-I-N-G, had more to do with smashing an enemy and carrying off his loot. The allure of plundering and pillaging notwithstanding, my own definition adheres strictly to the contemporary interpretation. The act of foraging, by this definition, encompasses all the various modes of food finding practiced by our pre-agrarian ancestors, including both the hunting and the gathering. Dictionaries aside, it seems most people, when considering the idea of foraging, place emphasis on the gathering part. My favorite description is one I heard not too long ago from another forager. He called it the act of collecting wild food that can't run away. Such a definition includes the plants and fungi that are implicit in the notion, not to mention slower animals, like clams and mussels, that are gathered rather than hunted. However, for the wide-ranging purposes of this book, I have taken the broader view, closer to that of Oxford. In the sections that follow, the forage includes wild foods that are gathered or otherwise caught by any means other than firearms. This includes various forms of fishing, with an angle or a spear, for instance, that some might consider to be a form of underwater hunting. The absence of firearms is not a commentary on my feelings about guns or hunting. Much to the contrary, learning how to hunt larger game will probably be the next step in my ongoing education as a modern-day forager. Prologue. As a graduate student in Seattle, I met an olive-skinned Polish-Italian beauty who wrote poetry and watched birds. She took me for a spring hike in the cool evergreen forests of the Cascade Mountains. I followed her movements in the woods as she bent to identify wildflowers along the trail and cocked an ear toward the mating calls of hidden thrushes. I was bowled over by her deep connection to nature. The natural world has always been a comfort to me. My grandparents introduced me to the swamps of Florida as a kid, and the woods near our suburban Connecticut house were a place of endless hideouts and exploration. But as I got older, these places grew more distant. Then I moved to Seattle, a city surrounded by woods, mountains, and water, and found myself seated in a literary theory class next to Martha, a grown woman who nevertheless decorated her walls with posters of local birds and flowers. I was in my early 20s, living by myself for the first time, and while Martha may have been excited to meet someone who appreciated Whitman and could identify a ruby-crowned kinglet by ear, other gaps in my education quickly began to reveal themselves to her. In 4 years of college in rural Vermont, I'd cracked open the great books of literature, but never cracked an egg. Cooking meant heating up a box of mac and cheese or opening a can of chili. I didn't know what garlic was and couldn't chop an onion. What Martha first saw in me, I cannot exactly say. After her first night at my apartment, I offered the next morning to cook her up what I considered a breakfast delicacy. My kitchen was tiny, more like a hotel kitchenette. I waved a dull goodwill knife in the air. "Stand back, Marty, and let the chef work his magic." Martha watched with intrigue and then carefully disguised horror as I pulled a package of Hormel Canadian bacon from the nearly bare refrigerator with a flourish, along with two plastic-wrapped slices of Kraft American cheese. "Taste one of my signature homemade egg muffins," I said suavely, "and you'll never eat at McDonald's again." She picked up the bacon package with thumb and forefinger and looked at it as if studying a stool sample. "I don't do McDonald's," she said dryly. I was confused. "What do you mean?" I stammered, struggling to open an English muffin with a fork. "Everyone eats there sometimes. 2 billion served." "Not me. I'm not counted in that tally." With that, she disappeared into the bathroom for a shower, cleansing herself of the thought of my cooking altogether, and left a few minutes later. Luckily, I got another chance. During a wet weekend of backpacking along the wild Pacific coast, we came upon what Martha declared a culinary bonanza. Like a person possessed, she dropped her pack and started rummaging through her pockets, looking for a knife. "The fruit of the rain," she kept saying, explaining that here beside the trail was a species of parasitic mushroom making a slow meal of a half-dead hemlock. Commonly known as chicken of the woods, the edible fungus looked like dozens of golden frisbees stacked vertically along the trunk of the tree. With a predatory vigor I had never seen before, Marty hacked off the freshest blooms and stuffed them into her pack. Back in town, I offered to cook up the mushrooms myself. Recently, I had perfected one of the mainstays of the graduate student cookbook, the stir fry. With potluck dinners and other gatherings happening just about weekly, I was discovering that it was important to know a few dishes that I could reliably feed to my fellow students and professors, all of whom were older and more experienced in the kitchen. Martha warily agreed, and we invited another couple over to join us. True to their name, the chicken of the woods mushrooms were firm and sautéed up nicely with garlic and ginger. I added onion and peppers and splashed on some soy sauce and sesame oil before serving them over rice. Everyone dug in. The food was warm and delicious. Our guests asked for seconds. "You ought to come diving with us for Dungeness crabs," they said. "There's nothing better than a meal you've foraged yourself. Living like a hunter-gatherer is good for the soul." And so began my education as a forager. Though I didn't come from a family of hunters, we had put down our weapons long ago, I soon learned from my hikes around the Northwest that it was still possible to gather a good meal in the wild. Even in the city. I'd been a fisherman since my late teens and was always a big eater. But now a much wider world of outdoor adventure and culinary exploration was beginning to reveal itself. Crabbing sounded like a good idea. Spending time outside and living off nature's bounty appealed to me. There was something romantic about freshly foraged food. Never again, I vowed silently, would I do something as unimaginative as try to copy a fast food recipe. In between bites of stir-fried chicken of the woods, Marty and I stole glances at each other. Her plate was soon clean, and her sated smile told me I was forgiven. Winter. Honey, get the gun. As stirring as the fake snow, choo-chooing model trains, and piped-in carols were on a December afternoon on the coast, we hadn't braved the local Ace Hardware's one-day sale and its crowd of wild-eyed shoppers to cross items off our Christmas lists. While Martha scanned a glass display case of utility knives, I left with my new gun and went next door to the liquor store where I purchased a bottle of dark rum. Outside, the sky was unseasonably clear. It would be cold tonight. We had come to the Pacific coast of Washington on a mission, entering ocean shores like everyone else through a pair of stone pillars that funnels traffic onto the little peninsula north of Gray's Harbor, the shallow estuarine bay first described by Captain Robert Gray, who also discovered the Columbia River 50 miles to the south. This is David Lynch country, the coastal equivalent of Twin Peaks. Southern California it is not, although certain town fathers, or developers at any rate, must have thought they could market it as such when they bought Point Brown Peninsula from the family that owned it in 1960. There are still no traffic lights in this hamlet of a few thousand souls, yet the boulevards are broad, three lanes in each direction at the main crossroads, anticipating a crush of cars that never quite materialized and resulting in confusing 12-way stop intersections that flummox the region's notoriously defensive drivers. Hotels and shopping malls seem determined to be anywhere else. There's a Nantucket Square, a Canterbury Inn, and a Polynesian resort. One of the two main drags is named Chance a la Mer. Martha was delighted to see that there was a bowling alley and instructed me to drop her off so she could indulge some retro Jersey Shore fantasy from her youth while I poked around. Beyond the downtown, I found a carefully platted community with empty cul-de-sacs, streets leading to nowhere, and a lot of scrub. Vacation houses along the beach, with the odd exception of a jaunty aquamarine-painted bungalow or a shingled Cape Cod-style cottage strung with colorful buoys, were drab and battened down with plain storm windows and non-fussy, out-of-the-box architectural details for handy weatherproofing. Many of them didn't even bother with decks overlooking the Pacific. The ocean, for that matter, was still far away, way out there beyond tall dunes and down a broad, sloping beach. Most of the time, it wasn't even visible. The houses get pounded all winter, and even in summer, they're usually shrouded in a cold and salty fog until noon. But on certain weekends during the off-season, the beaches come alive. At least, at dusk, they do. Like extras in a topsy-turvy Annette Funicello romp, crowds come out dressed in their finest North Coast beachwear. Parkas, rain jackets, fleece, long johns, hats, and gloves. People line the beach as far as you can see in either direction, thousands of them. If there's a bikini, it's of the undergarment variety. Everyone carries lanterns and flashlights, and they're armed to the teeth. Joining the crowd out on the beach an hour before low tide, it didn't take me long to draw a bead with my new gun. I aimed and commenced to digging. It was open season on razor clams. Like noodling for flatheads in the Delta, running a sap line in New England, or dropping a baited hook through a hole in the ice in the Great White North, digging razor clams is a peculiar and time-honored expression of regional identity. Being a transplant, I suppose I didn't catch on to this fact right away. Martha and I were both from the East Coast. Our idea of a good clam was straight out of the boardwalk clam shack. They don't do clams like that out here, we figured. We didn't even know what a razor clam looked like. Golden-hued and shaped like a straight-edged razor, the Pacific razor clam, Silica patula for open pod, makes its home along the sandy, storm-tossed beaches of the Northwest, from Pismo Beach, California, to the Aleutian Islands of Alaska, where they earn a living filtering plankton, particularly a species of diatom known as Athea armatus, which lives in the surf and can turn the water black like an oil slick if present in sufficient numbers. Breeding is a haphazard affair. Razors are disciples of the hit-or-miss method of reproduction. They broadcast eggs and sperm on the sand in large quantities, and fertilization is strictly by chance. The young clam begins life as a free-swimming larva until its shell begins to harden, whereupon it burrows into the clam beds of the intertidal zone, anywhere from a few feet above the low tide mark to a half mile out at sea, and settles down to grow into the big, meaty adult that has enticed humans and many other predators, including grizzly bears, for millennia. The fully grown shell is typically between 3 and 6 inches long, though larger specimens, up to 11 inches, have been found in the northern reaches of its range. In Washington, a razor clam of 6 inches is considered a prize. One fisheries biologist told a local paper that he had never collected one larger than 6 1/4 inches, although a friend of his claimed to have found one 6 1/2 inches long and 3 inches across. A real lunker. Factor in that the soft body of the clam extends well beyond the shell in its natural, unthreatened state, and you get an idea of how meaty they can be. A single good-sized razor clam might have more usable flesh on it than a small quail. Which brings us back to the gun, an ingenious device. Nothing more than a humble length of PVC or metal pipe with a handle attached. It's used to unearth the wily razor from its lair beneath the sand. Striking a pose like a hard hat-wearing jackhammerer, the clam digger works his tube several inches down into the wet sand before closing a vent on the handle. With suction, he can now pull up a core of sand, and, if he's skilled, a razor clam secreted within. It's not as easy as it might seem. Razor clams are fast. Though reports vary, one researcher clocked a razor burying itself at a rate of 1 inch per second. At that pace, I refuse to entertain snide remarks about fair chase. These tubes are by far the weapons of choice for extracting the clams. Wherever you go on the coast, you hear clammers referring to their guns. But in truth, the term was originally coined to describe a small angled shovel invented in the 1940s and used for the same purpose. Naturally, as with any other long-standing tradition, there are old-school clammers who will eagerly correct you if you call your tube a gun. But everyone does, and so did I. The sun was dropping fast. People and their vehicles lined the beach. The outdated tradition of allowing cars and trucks to tear up and down the beach, spewing exhaust fumes and leaving waffle-patterned tire tracks in the sand, lives on in parts of Washington state. Already a swath of clam bed was in disarray, the diggings heaped on the hardpan sand like the work of giant earthworms. Clam diggers were whooping it up. "Limits for everyone," I heard a shaggy-looking logger type bellow through his beard. Apparently, it was a good crop. After failing to hit pay dirt on my own first few pulls, I walked a little ways to find an unmolested stretch of beach. I wouldn't say that panic was setting in, but already I was getting a ghost-like taste of fried clam on my tongue, a tantalizing reminder of the empty mesh bag that hung limply from my belt. "It's okay," I assured myself. "I'm new to this. How hard can it be?" As if answering my own question, there in the wet sand, clear as my thumb, was what I had been looking for. A show, the round, quarter-sized impression made by a clam's siphon as it lies buried in the sand. And then another. The telltale signs of razor clams were all around me, X's on a treasure map. I took aim with the gun and worked it into the sand. The sand gave way easily, until I heard the sickening crunch of breaking shell. Smashed bits of razor clam came up with my core. By law, I was required to keep what was left of the bifurcated bivalve. My next pull repeated the carnage. I dropped the mangled carcass sheepishly in my bag. Nearby, a guy danced around on the flats with a mesh sack heavy with clams. He was beaming with good fortune. "Excuse me, but..." I held up the broken fragments of my first two clams. The man chuckled, his mustache twitching. "Don't talk to me. I'm just holding the bag," he said, with almost too much lip-smacking anticipation in his voice for me to bear. He pointed to a young woman in purple rain pants who was bent over her tube with fierce intent. "Talk to my daughter. She knows all." "Here," he grabbed my elbow. "I'll bring you over to her so she doesn't think you're some kind of stalker." The daughter, preoccupied with her own hunting, was slightly embarrassed at my ineptitude. Obviously, I didn't strike her as either a stalker or serious competition on the clam beds. "Not much to it," she said, looking at me doubtfully. "Not really. You just dig. Don't be afraid of getting dirty." Dirty? Did she think I was afraid of getting dirty? Did I look like someone who was determined to stay clean? "Of course," I said, "but how do I avoid, wastage?" I was using the term preferred by the Fish and Wildlife authorities. It sounded suddenly pedantic. "You mean smashed clams?" She assured me it happened to nearly everyone. They say never turn your back on the ocean, and as a rogue wave crashed the party and sent clammers scrambling for higher ground, I now understood why. Rushing water hit me at the knees and flooded my rubber boots. The North Pacific is unmerciful to those who don't follow the rules, and sometimes it's equally unkind to those who do. Signs up and down the beaches warn swimmers, even with 50-degree temperatures, there are still those insistent on a dip, of the dangers of the powerful surf, riptides, and, unique to this neck of the woods, errant widowmaker logs escaped from logging operations that roll in without notice. With soggy feet, I made my way back up the beach through darkness with a hard-won limit of clams, some of them in pieces, but others big and whole and glorious. My cold, wet walk reminded me of a great Henry Weinhard's beer commercial from a few years back. A bunch of young slackers are on the dunes drinking beers, goatees, a lot of grunge wear. "Here come the hotties," one announces. Cut to a shot of the windswept beach with a cold, gray ocean backdrop and a bunch of young women. Not half clad, but in so many layers of foul weather gear that each one looks like nothing so much as the Michelin Man. Marty was waiting for me at the campsite with a bucket of seawater for the clams, a blazing fire, and hot rum toddies on the stove. "Was it worth it?" she asked rather ambiguously, eyebrows arched. In the past, it was true, I had been content to stay closer to home and dig up a limit of another smaller yet more abundant species, the non-native Manila clam, which was established in Puget Sound early in the last century. The limit on Manilas was 40 per day. They're easy to find and delicious in a hearty pasta alla vongole, or clam pasta, which Martha had taught me how to make, and which I now insisted on calling by its Italian name. Razor clams, on the other hand, have a more blue-collar, northwestern appeal. No French or Italian spellings here, thank you. These are clams for the deep fryer, the clams that Northwest grandmothers make into chowder. As cultural icons, they predate floating bridges, the Space Needle, and cheap electricity. And to see an old-timey picture of the hordes on the beach digging clams is to be confronted with not only an ocean of plaid flannel, but a history of hunting and gathering that dates back 10,000 years. A limit of razor clams didn't mean a lot of fancy work in the kitchen, either. Even today, there are only a handful of recipes that one sees again and again. Fried razor clams, spaghetti with razor clam sauce, razor clam chowder, and let's not forget razor clam fritters, with the secret ingredient in one well-known recipe being crushed cheddar cheese goldfish crackers. This is all a way of saying that razor clams are very much a local delicacy. It's only natural, then, that the good old days of razor clam digging are long gone. You can thank Grandma for that squander, too. Like so many other wild foods, the resource was depleted by overharvest and disease. In Washington State, you could dig razor clams 9 months out of the year until not that long ago, which translated into a recreational harvest of between 6 and 13 million clams annually. Now the harvest is carefully managed, to say the least. You get as few as 15 to 35 days, with a limit of 15 clams per person per day. Oregon has taken a different approach, with a more wide-open season and a poorer catch rate as a result. If all this weren't bad enough, there's another, more recent concern facing clam diggers. Domoic acid, which can drive seabirds crazy and make humans forget what they ate for breakfast, or worse. The toxin was first discovered in Pacific shellfish in 1991 and led to immediate harvest closures. Razor clam digging in Washington was banned for a year. While domoic acid doesn't seem to bother the fish and shellfish it infects, in humans and other animals high up the food chain, it enters the brain and warps nerve signals. The human illness is known as amnesic shellfish poisoning. Symptoms include headache, dizziness, confusion, loss of short-term memory, motor weakness, seizures, cardiac arrhythmia, and coma. High doses can even lead to death. There is no antidote. The toxin is responsible for several deaths in North America. In 1998, 400 California sea lions were killed by domoic acid. It is also now believed that domoic acid was responsible for the stranger-than-fiction event that inspired Alfred Hitchcock to make The Birds. In the summer of 1961, hundreds of sooty shearwaters, a pelagic species that eats mostly fish and comes ashore only to breed, invaded the town of Capitola, California. The mad birds attacked people, crashed through windows, and wreaked havoc. These days, state biologists must regularly test shellfish samplings from up and down the coast before they can announce an opening. The next morning, I awoke to discover just how much of a rookie I truly was. Masked robbers had invaded our camp during the night. The muddy imprints of little paws drew larcenous arabesques atop the picnic table and benches, the scene of a wild barn dance under the moon. Half-eaten razor clams, pilfered from the bucket, lay strewn across the ground, a dozen of them. Martha convinced me that there would be no salvaging partially eaten pawed-over razors. "They have diseases, you know," she explained to me carefully, as if I were a simpleton. "Yeah, but, and what if they pooped on your clams? They don't wash up before dinner, do they? They didn't raid our stash of antiseptic wet wipes, did they?" "Uh-huh." I didn't like these rhetorical questions, but there was no stopping her. "They may be fastidious little brutes, but you wouldn't want a chance eating clams played with by feces-encrusted raccoons." I looked at the ruins on the ground, then balefully at Martha. She smiled the exasperating smile of the sensible. "Chance à la mer." That evening, toting my gun, I went back out for my second limit. Low tide was scheduled for 6:11 p.m., well after sunset. This time the clams were more persnickety about dropping clues to their whereabouts. I wandered around without seeing a single show. As luck would have it, I was working a stretch of beach next to a guy who clearly knew what he was doing. Even though the clam shows, for whatever arbitrary reason, were few and far between, this fella didn't care. He stalked them anyway, shifting into some deeply atavistic mode that I couldn't even begin to understand. Maybe he had X-ray vision. While I looked high and low for a show, he took one or two big steps with his gun, and then, kerplunk, he was at it again, rocking his tube into the ground and nonchalantly pulling up a core of wet sand. Each time, his two young daughters protested their father's uncanny skill. "I don't see it," they'd say skeptically, to which he'd grunt and give the core a little kick with his boot, the wet cylinder of sand losing its shape and falling apart to reveal the wriggling snout of yet another giant razor clam. "Eek!" the girls would squeal with delight, and he'd reply, "Go ahead, pick it up." I could only surmise that in giving his wife and daughters the pleasure of the final capture, he was able to extend the 15 clam limit to each family member, giving his little consortium an actual limit of 60 clams. 60! I wanted to crack this guy over the noggin with my gun. The pinch of envy reminded me of competitive morel hunting and salmon fishing. It was a debilitating emotion that could only lead to further moral dissipation and a general funk. Should I walk away immediately and find a new patch of beach? Confess my ineptitude and beg for help? Better to watch and learn, I decided. Unlike many of the clammers around us who roamed far and wide in search of the elusive show, this mollusk clairvoyant was digging in a fairly contained area. Each time he successfully dug up a clam, he moved a couple of steps and was into another one. I slowed down and studied the sand. Where there was a tiny aberration, not really the dimple of a show, just the slightest indentation, I dug anyway and came away with a nice-sized razor. While pulling up my core, I watched the sand around me change color as the surrounding moisture leached into the tube. The sand turned from dark to light and exposed two more indentations that had previously escaped my eye. I marked these before retrieving my clam and then went back to them. Again, a couple more clams in the bag. It was well after dark when I made my limit, but it was a limit, by God, and I could go home with head high. The light of my headlamp led me up to the dunes and along a trail to the campground, where hundreds of clammers in RVs were already cooking up their catch and clinking celebratory beer bottles. Truth be told, Martha is a little bit squeamish. The huge clams in our bucket scared her the whole drive home with their long, lolling necks probing their captivity, and those muscular feet that seemed capable of burrowing right into your palm if you picked one up. She didn't like the idea of having them in her basement either, so I went ahead and cleaned them while she was out. Unlike most clams, razors must be cleaned before eating. I poured boiling water over the clams for 10 seconds or so, as instructed by the state fish and wildlife brochure. And sure enough, the golden shells started popping open, revealing their treasures. Next, I removed the meat, which came away easily enough. With a pair of scissors, I nipped off the tough black tip of the siphon and slit the clam from neck to foot in order to remove the dark parts, the gills and palps. I also butterflied the clam's foot, or digger, removing a transparent tube known as the crystalline style, which acts as a sort of tenderizer, breaking down the hard shells of diatoms in its diet with digestive enzymes. The foot is the juiciest part of the clam. This took a half hour or so, and when I was done, I had a colander full of glistening clams, creamy, translucent, and fresh as could be. I scooped up handfuls and let them slide through my fingers back into the colander, imagining to what purpose I could put each handful. I felt like Daffy Duck in Alibaba Bunny when he finds the Sultan's treasure trove. "I'm rich! I'm wealthy! Yahoo! I'm comfortably well off!" I, too, wanted to do the backstroke among my pile of glittering clams. Let me just say this about the golden razor clam. If you enjoy a cup of chowder now and again, or a greasy plate of fried longnecks at the clam shack, you don't know what you're missing. At first, I was happy enough to dig the more common varieties that lay just beneath the surface of Puget Sound's clam beds, little necks, manillas, and the like. Steamed with a little white wine, parsley, and garlic, these make excellent table fare in their own right. But when it comes to true American comfort food, the razor clam is king. We're taught that bigger is not necessarily better. Not so with the razor. A single limit of 15 clams was enough for a kettle of chowder and a fried clam dinner, with an appetizer portion of leftovers for the freezer to boot. Size, in this case, has zero impact on flavor. My trophy clam, 6 inches on the nose, was just as tender and sweet as the smaller ones. The chowder we made was like none I had ever tasted, ebullient with the essence of clam rather than overwhelmed by potato or cream. The experience not unlike gulping down raw oysters, a delirious taste of the sea. And the fried clams? You haven't really eaten this venerable seaside basket meal until you've tried fresh razors. The flavor knocked us out. To think we had wasted all this time not eating fresh razor clams. It was enough to make us blubber in our baskets. Until we remembered the end of that classic Bugs Bunny episode, when the duo, now penniless, had been banished from the sands of Arabia. Well, here we are, Pismo Beach and all the clams we can eat. Razor Clam Chowder. To make my first razor clam chowder, I had to ask around a lot. As a youth, I worked at a Martha's Vineyard restaurant famous for its chowder, whipped, creamy, and so thick you could spread it on toast points. But that miraculous float-a-cherry-on-top creaminess didn't come from any particular technique or wizardry in the kitchen. It came from giant cans labeled chowder base. My grandmother Mimi used to make a New England-style fish chowder when all the relatives gathered on Cape Cod for the 4th of July weekend. I can remember watching epic tennis matches between Bjorn Borg and John McEnroe while slurping down the chowder with a lot of oyster crackers thrown in for good measure. But once Mimi was gone, the recipe was too. I've tried to recreate it with both clams and cod, and after consulting with numerous cousins, aunts, and uncles over the years, I'm pretty sure I've almost got it. A key ingredient is thyme. And don't even consider making this chowder without bacon. 4 to 5 strips, about 1/4 pound of thick quality bacon, diced. 1 large onion sliced into wide half moons. 2 to 3 cups peeled and cubed red potatoes, 3 tablespoons butter, 3 tablespoons flour, 1 quart chicken stock or clam juice or a mixture of both, 1 heaping teaspoon dried thyme, salt and freshly ground black pepper to taste, 1 pint heavy cream or half and half, 2 cups chopped razor clams with as much juice as can be salvaged. Sauté bacon in heavy pot over medium heat until crispy. Remove with slotted spoon and set aside on paper towel. Sauté onions a few minutes in bacon fat. Add potatoes and cook, stirring occasionally, until potatoes start to brown slightly. Remove onion-potato mixture for later. Melt butter in same pot and slowly mix in flour to make a roux. The roux is ready when it starts to color up, turning a faint yellowish and then pinkish. Slowly add stock. Return onions and potatoes to pot and simmer until potatoes are tender, about 20 minutes. Add thyme and seasonings. Slowly stir in cream, then add clams and cook over low heat another 10 minutes. Taste and adjust seasonings. Sprinkle with reserved bacon, crumbled if desired. Serve hot with good bread or oyster crackers. Serves 8. Doing that squid jig. Seattle is a sad, wet place in the depths of winter, after the last of the holiday bulbs has blinked out and the tinsel is boxed up and carted off. Sometimes, this time of year, I head downtown looking for a little nightlife. Tonight I drive past the Space Needle and the bars and nightclubs of trendy Belltown, past the row of shiny new biotech buildings on the waterfront, and park at the foot of the old grain terminal. Next door is the public fishing pier. The Happy Hooker bait shop is shuttering for the night, but the crowd on the pier has a high-powered halogen spotlight hooked up to a car battery, and everyone is on their feet, pressed up against the railing and gibbering in a dozen different languages. Anticipation is thick. There's a shout at the far end of the pier, then cheering as tentacled beasts come flying out of the water, squirting water and ink. The squid bite is on. I'd been thinking about squid lately because there's an Italian dish I'd heard about that was supposed to be a Christmas specialty in Venice, a dish with cuttlefish, which is a close relative of the squid. It seemed so over the top to me, and somehow, just for symbolic reasons, so antithetical to the usual red and green and white of the season, that I just had to try it. In Italy, they call it risotto nero con sepe, black risotto with cuttlefish. Black because of the ink. There aren't too many jet black foods out there, certainly not as a main course. Though another Christmas had come and gone with the inevitable nod to a sleep-inducing roast turkey, I resolved on New Year's Eve to learn the secrets of risotto and mentioned my resolution to Marty. I told her I was determined to make a feast that would impress even her relatives in the old country. Not that I would be seeing any of these relatives. They live in Italy in the shadow of Vesuvius. But I liked to think we would go over there one day, maybe even for good. Learning a new language would be the least of our difficulties, and yet the thought of all those regions, Veneto, Liguria, Campania, each with its own character and cuisine, made it all seem like a worthwhile venture. I liked to imagine the day we met Martha's relatives, how we would visit the cemetery where her people were laid to rest, and then, after stumbling through ancient ruins and meeting one person after another in town with the same last name, Silano, Martha's name, we would return to the family casa. In my fantasy, I needed to be prepared. They would be welcoming in the Italian tradition. I would offer to help in the kitchen. You cook? See. Well, sort of. More squid plopping into buckets woke me from my impossible reverie. I was missing the bite. But before I could occupy an open slot along the rail, a tiny Cambodian woman, her face a welter of wrinkles, beat me to it. She looked up at me with an enigmatic smile before turning her attention back to the water below. "Gotta be quick, bro," someone called out down the line. He stepped aside to give me a little room, and again, before I could claim the spot, the same woman snuck in like a California Parker, this time letting loose a string of what I took to be sarcastic Khmer invective. My would-be ally on the rail snickered. "She's going for the spotlight, bro." As everyone knew, the best action was right where the luminescence hit the water. A few casts later and she was on the move again, a moth closing in on the bright light at the center of the squid-jigging universe. This time I jumped into the vacancy before another opportunistic jigger could move. I had my crummy trout rod with me, a gallon bucket, and a pocket full of lures known as squid jigs. Shaped like a miniature cigar with a circular fan of hooks at one end, the squid jig is a happy marriage of form and function. The hooks aren't what you might think. They radiate outward like the ribs of an umbrella, more than a dozen J-shaped hooks that are not meant to impale so much as to entangle. The squid fastens onto the jig and is reeled in before it can escape. Jigs come in many different colors, most popularly glow-in-the-dark shades of green and pink. When the bite is on, squid jigging looks easy, though like anything else, it's a skill that takes practice to learn. First, the squid jigger needs to figure out how deep to fish his lure. Then comes the jig itself, the wrist-flicking motion of the rod that makes the lure dance tantalizingly up and down. When a squid latches onto the lure, a barely perceptible twinge runs up the line, along the rod, and into the neural receptors of the squid jigger's fingers. So it is with most fishing, but the strike of the squid is subtle, to say the least, which is why jiggers are constantly jigging, like action painters covering a huge canvas. Some jiggers think the squid waits until that imperceptible moment between the jigs falling and rising to attack while the glowing lure is hanging in midwater and vulnerable. Others say the squid attacks on the downbeat. Still others insist the squid isn't attacking at all. It's loving, they say. The idea is to pull up just as the squid has wrapped itself on the lure. Then it's stuck and hurtling toward the surface, with the weight of the water keeping it pinned on the jig. As you look down the row of jiggers, the movement of rods bending up and down has its own mechanical, if somewhat disjointed, rhythm, like a contraption from the earliest days of the assembly line. The kid next to me was from Nicaragua and dressed in an Oakland Raiders windbreaker. I used to see kids in Raiders jackets on my corner when I lived in San Francisco. Too poor to buy proper gang jackets, they settled for the ready-made toughness of the one-eyed pirate, flashing their colors on that corner for a year of intimidation and petty crime before a rival gang's midnight drive-by ended their turf claim. The raider introduced himself as Victor. Victor was hauling up dinner like some kind of squid Svengali. "Bro, you gotta get the technique right," he said to me, taking pity on my empty bucket. Yeah, I knew about the technique. It wasn't like I was a novice, though admittedly I was a little bit rusty. I hadn't been squid jigging since the previous winter. I brought the rod tip up and let it sink. Just as I thought my jig was at the bottom of its stroke, I lifted up again. A nearly impalpable tug vibrated up the line and through the tip of my rod, enough so that my fingers started reeling before my mind even registered the impulse. The squid broke the surface and shot out a powerful stream as if from a water pistol. Victor sidestepped to avoid the ink that came next. Calamar!
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.